Hi everyone, welcome to this new video. This is the chapter 17. The chapter is Oligopoly. This is a book of Gregory Mankiw. The book is Principles of Economics, 7th edition. So in this video we're going to discuss about one of the different structures of the markets. Before, we already saw different markets as perfect competition, as monopoly, and monopolistic competition. So during this new video, we're going to discuss about a new structure of market, which is actually really, you can find easily in different goods or services. As a matter of fact, we can have, we can like explain that with, for example, tennis balls, because there are different brands around the market, but actually there are not too much. So for example, you can think about Wilson, okay, or maybe you can think about Penn or Dunlop. So those few firms, they control all the market, okay? So the characteristic of oligopoly basically is that there are just few sellers, and actually there is a strong interdependence between companies. What does it mean? Basically it means that the decision that one chooses, it will affect the other's decision. So this is like the interaction between the companies and the main characteristic of oligopoly structure market. They sell similar or identical products. Definitely they are different from perfect competition, because the idea is like perfect competition, they have like no market power at all, they are price takers. But in oligopoly, they fix the prices. Okay, so here, for this reason, there is a new tool that this should be introduced in order to have a look for that kind of new topic. This is the game theory. Basically, the game theory we can define as the study of how people behave in a strategic situation. So it's like how people choose the best strategy or the best election depending on others' decision as well. So for this reason, strategic we can define as what one person chooses, it takes into account others' decision. So this is the interconnection inside oligopoly. So at the end of the day, the profit of each of those firms, Wilson, Penn and Dunlop, the profit depends also on others' firms. It's not like what I'm going to produce, and we need to take into account what the others do. It's important to take into account that, because before, in perfect competition, it didn't matter, because actually you are not any incidence in the price, and as a monopolist, it's exactly the same, because you're the only one inside the market, so you don't need to take into account the others' decision. So, as I said before, the game theory is not really necessary for previous analysis, because there was not that those like kind of connection between firms. But this one, this important and powerful tool that could be used for business analysis or even just a simple tennis game, because it depends on interaction among players. So, here, the key is like there are like two situations mainly. So between those firms, there are few firms inside the market, they have two options, two branches of decision. They can cooperate or pursue self-interest. Okay, so the idea is like when you sum all the benefits inside for a oligopoly, they are definitely best off when they incorporate and they act or simulate to be a monopolist and just split the total profits between the players. The idea is like they would like to charge the maximum possible price as the monopolist, which is definitely compared with the average total cost. And why? Remember the definition of the profits. So profits are defined as the total revenue minus the total cost. Here we know that we can divide that expression that total revenue is exactly equal to the price times the quantity you sell, and the total cost you can divide over, you can put over a Q, but if you put that, you make that movement, you need to cancel out with another Q in order to remain everything the same. So here, you know the total cost over Q is exactly the definition of the average total cost. So what is the actually the average cost of the total production? So here you have that. So you know already that you have Q, and Q over here, you can collect terms, and you have the Q parentheses P minus average total cost is what we are talking about. The maximum this gap, the maximum profit you will have. Obviously depending on the quantities, but we know the quantities, obviously, they should be positive. Okay, this is basically the idea. So for this reason, the corporation will charge the maximum price, which actually simulates the monopoly price. So then we can take that a duopoly example, so just two firms. Obviously, we know that oligopolies most of the time compose for more companies, but it doesn't matter. We can just make that example to remain things easy, and even that we can take the important part that we need in order to understand the oligopoly. So then the oligopolies will face the same issues. So here we have the example that there are two members of a town and they own wells for drinking water. So the idea is like they both decide how much quantity water to pump to offer to town. So this is the kind of the strategy. The strategy will be focused on what should be this quantity in order to receive benefit. What should be the best, but I need to take into account what the order will play as well. So then, you know, the price determined by the market, but a demand schedule. So then they can say, okay, this is an important assumption that both can pump water as much as they want. There are no costs. So it means automatically the marginal cost is zero. Remember, the marginal cost is the additional cost for one additional unit produced. So for this reason, we have total cost zero. So then in order to keep the profits kind of simple. So here we have the demand schedule. So here we have three columns. We have the quantity, okay, from 0 to 120. Those quantities, they are like measured by gallons. Then we have the price. What is the relationship between quantity and price? Remember, the price is going to be, once the quantity is going up, the price will be go down. So this is kind of inverse relationship between them. So when there is no zero, there are going to be no any quantity demanded when the price is 120. And then once the price is going down, the quantities will go up. And then the total revenue, which is exactly equal to the total profit because there are no costs. So for this reason, it's just going to be the multiplication between the quantity and the price. So it should be 0 times 120 or 70 times 50. So it should be 3,500. So those are the total revenue. Okay, this is the demand schedule. So here for demand schedule, we understand the quantity of price, and here we add the total revenue and total profit. So then, before going more into that example that I guess that you already understand well, that there are two producers of drinking water that they pump a well and they split the market, and it depends benefit on the total production, the sum of both of them. Okay, so we already knew that a perfectly competitive market, it has the rule that the price is exactly equal to the marginal cost. Okay, basically because the price would reflect the cost of producing it. It's like the most or the fairest price that you can use. The other side of that coin is like the monopolist, because they will have the maximum total profit. Okay, and then the basic difference in terms of efficiency. Remember, the perfectly competitive is like the most kind of efficient in the way for welfare situation, because the there will not be like any deadweight loss as we saw in previous videos. So here we have the situation when we have the situation of perfectly competitive, okay, when the price is exactly equal to the marginal cost. Remember, the marginal cost of that well is zero because there are no additional costs when they pump more water, and the quantity, the total quantity produced, should be 120, and the profits of a perfectly competitive market is naturally equal to zero. What is the difference from the monopolist point of view? Basically, they will charge the maximum, okay, where definitely the price is 60, which is higher definitely than the marginal cost, okay? Obviously, it's not higher than 60 because the total revenue and equal to the total profit will be lower. So definitely, this should be the decision of the maximum. So the oligopoly, when they reach an agreement, they should be around here. But we will see that even when they start to compete between them, they never will reach the perfectly competitive outcome. Okay, so that's already the idea of that. So then, both competitors, they can agree which should be the optimal quantity produced. So the first kind of idea, what should be like the first attempt, should be collusion. Collusion is where when the firms, they agree on price or quantity. So they establish a meeting and they say, okay, let's fix this amount of the quantity that we will produce, but it's important to know that we cannot deviate. So it's something that to be behind that in order to enforce that agreement, which is sometimes, or actually the most of the times, the most difficult things of collusion, because there are a lot of incentives to deviate. So here, the idea is like when firms act in the same way, they act at the unison, is a cartel. So a cartel is when they act in the same way, so they reply the same actions, so they should be a cartel. And they act as a monopoly, and all analysis of chapter 15 can be applied. Okay, so because they at the end they act as a monopoly, and you just split profits between the firms that they are inside that cartel, and this should be the benefits for all of them. The idea is like if both firms in the water pump collude, they will charge $60. Why $60? Remember in the previous slide that we verify that the monopoly outcome should be 60 quantity, okay, the 60 gallons, sorry, and then the price naturally should be 60. So that could not be efficient, okay, not be efficient in terms of the perfectly competition. So then, the idea is like each member would like to have a larger part of the market. It should be more profitable. Because why? Under collusion, if firms will produce 30 gallons. Why? Because the total production is 60 gallons split between these two firms. So naturally, it should be 30 gallons. The price that you will charge at 30 gallons should be $60. That should be $60 times 30 gallons. So the total benefit for each firm should be $1,800. So that's the idea when they collude, when they have an agreement. But actually, in the reality, what happened? The idea is like we already realized that this is like the ideal situation for those oligopolies where they maximize the benefits because they behave actually as a monopolist. But then, as I said before, reach that agreement with competitors should be almost impossible. Because actually, first, and the most important one, I guess, is like there are antitrust laws. And actually, they prohibit explicit agreement, so you cannot get together with different companies and fix or enforce a price quantity, because due to the antitrust laws, this is not possible. This is illegal. Okay, so for this reason, it cannot be possible. So then, the idea is like without an agreement, they will produce the quantities of monopoly. This is like the idea. Okay, we don't discuss anything, but we know that if I move to that position, the other will understand that both we will reach a higher benefit as a joint, so maybe this should be the best solution. But actually, Without binding agreement, this is, should be almost impossible. You have a strong incentives to deviate. Let's have a look here. So here, this is the production that they both decide. Okay. Let's move on. When we produce 60 gallons in total, so 30 gallons each one. And then what happened? Let's imagine that one says, when it's kind of smart, so clever, and say, okay, you, I know that you will produce 30 gallons. Let's try to get a larger piece of that cake, and I will move to 40. So automatically, when I move to 40, I will have 40, and the other one still produce 30. And naturally, I will have more benefits. Why? Let's have a look to numbers. So here we have the movement that I represented before, and then we know that this is the total revenue, price times Q equal to total profits, because there are no costs, remember, and then should be 60, the price, and the quantities 30. So for this reason, you have the total profits 1,800, okay? Then imagine, says, okay, I'm going to deviate because it's going to be better for me, so then I will sell now 40. When I sell 40, automatically the price goes down from 60 to 50, and then the price should be, the quantity should be 40, and then automatically, you see, my benefits will increase. So I said, okay, I prefer to produce more. So then the other one, which is still remained the same with the same 30 production, but the price of 50, because the price goes down, is the same price for all the market. And then the total revenue should be 1,500. Still the joint, we have 3,500. So the total benefits of the oligopolist, it reduced, but actually the total revenue or total profit for one firm increased. So for this reason, this first firm, it has the benefit or the incentive to deviate. But the other one says, okay, you move, okay, I can move as well. I'm not going to remain the same. So then both will sell 40 gallons. Okay, so then we are now in this position. We are in 80 because each one produces 40 gallons, but the price will go down to 40, and the total benefits will be even worse than the previous situation, 3,200. And naturally, the total revenue or total profit for each firm should be 1,600. Okay, so the idea is, like, if any firm pursues its own interest, so the quantity should be more than monopolies. Here, the quantities for a monopoly situation should be 60, and then should be 80, and naturally, the price should be lower. Okay, so that's the basic idea. Let's think about if they continue to move. Okay, so they are already here. So they say, okay, I'm going to produce 50. So they should be price 30 times 50. And then the total revenue should be 1,500. So automatically, it's better to stop. It's better to say, okay, we're going to keep in that position. Okay, so even they compete, they never will reach the perfectly competition price, which was zero. Okay, so for more competition, that it should be present in the market, they will not go to this price. It should be something in between most of the time. So this is, looks like some sort of equilibrium, because no one will move more because they will lose money. So for this reason, actually, this is called the Nash equilibrium. Actually, this is represented with the Brilliant Mind, the movie, which is not like specific real representation of the theory, but it makes you kind of an idea what this guy says. This guy says basically that due to most of the people, they are irrationally individual, so for this reason, everyone act as a self and interest, like motivation, the outcome should not be the best for all players inside that. Okay, so for this reason, each actor chooses the best strategy due to all others have chosen, and the most important thing, they don't have any incentive to move from that standpoint situation. Okay, so then this should be considered the 80 quantity, kind of the Nash equilibrium. Because this 90, this shouldn't be the more profitable for the players. Okay, so that to the 80, the firms don't have any incentives to move. So here, the firms obviously will be better cooperating, but they will not if they don't enforce the sufficient agreement. At the end, the self-interest, because of that, this outcome is not reached. So then, the idea is like, imagine that another two firms find water. So then there are no more duopoly. So we are now in a oligopoly where there are four firms. Actually, we can assume that the demand schedule remains exactly the same. And the situation, they can make a cartel, but the price they will try to fix should be the monopoly price. And now, actually, when there are more firms, commitment is even more difficult because, you know, just should be likely one of them can deviate, and once one moves, other ones, they don't have any incentive to remain in the same strategy. So then the idea is like, when each firm decides, they think about two options, as we saw previous in the monopoly situation. They have the output effect, you know, that the price is above the marginal cost. So when that situation appears, they can sell more gallons and they will raise profits. And then they should struggle with the price effect as well, because the raise in production will increase the amount sold, okay, but which will lower the price, and profits maybe will decrease. So the idea is like, if the output effect is higher than the price effect, the ones that make the profits higher and the one that make the profit lower, if that is higher one to the other one, the well owner will increase production. And when the price effect is higher than the output effect, well owners does not increase production. The situation that we realized before, once they increase production and then the price effect is higher than the output effect, they will stop. So then even it is profitable to reduce production. Then when we have larger number of sellers, there is a less impact on the market. So because any time that ones change the price, there is not the same impact when they are just a duopoly or a monopoly, where the impact should be total one. So then the magnitude of price effects falls, this incidence in the price. So the complete idea, when there is not incidence at all, is when we are talking about competitive market, where the price effect actually is absent. Then we can think about, this is kind of related with chapter 3, when we talk about interdependence of the trade, the importance of the national trade, where there are more players, more variety, and prices goes down. So this competition, we already kind of understand that even they, it makes worse the players, but maybe the society should be even better. So this should be this trade-off between those. So then we can think about the economics of cooperation. So we already realized that the best result is monopoly outcome for the players, but obviously it requires cooperation, and then we need to have a look to game theory. So for this reason, we are going to start to understand basic tools of game theory with the prisoner's dilemma. It shows definitely that cooperation is totally difficult. If you understand prisoner's dilemma, you can understand any game 2x2. You should be okay for that. If you already understand this already basic, you can go more, obviously, deeper in the game theory issue. So actually, even there is a mutual beneficial, it is a result that is not possible to charge, to reach, basically because players, they are interested on self-interest results. And remember, we are individual irrational. We don't care about the other ones, and we prefer to have better outcome for ourselves. Okay, so the idea is like, there are two criminals captured by the police, and then police have enough evidence to convict them for carrying an unregistered gun. Each would spend 1 year in a jail. This should be like, you already will be convicted for that, and you will be 1 year in a jail. But actually, there is another part, that is that they likely committed a robbery, but there is not enough evidence, and they need help from people, from the criminals. So then they took them and they split them in different rooms. This is the start of the game. So then they say, okay, you can stay 1 year in jail Because why? Because you already know that you were carrying an unregistered gun, or maybe you can confess and you will be free. But because you confess, your partner should be 20 years in jail. So, but if both confess the crime, you will have both 8 years. Then, remember that they are criminals and they just care about themselves. So here is how we represent the game theory, where we can summarize the ideas. So here we have the decisions of Bonnie, which is one of the criminals, and the decision of Clyde. They have two options. They have they can confess and they can remain silent. Remember, they already will be convicted for unregistered gun. Okay, so if Clyde's remains silent and at the same time Bonnie's decision is remaining silent, both will get 1 year. Okay, this should be the outcome. But this is the trick, what is so interesting here. Okay, then imagine that Bonnie's decision, okay, but what about if I confess, okay, Bonnie's decision here, what about if I confess, okay, and the other still remain silent, the Clyde doesn't say anything, so Bonnie goes free. So what's the idea of that? The Bonnies have a lot of incentive to deviate, because he will say, okay, I won't remain silent, I will confess, I will be free, and the other one, I don't care, he will get 20 years. Now, let's think about the other side. Clyde's decision is remain silent, okay, and the other one remains silent, okay? And he says, okay, I'll better confess, and then if I confess and the other remained silent, I will be free. And then, the other one, I don't care, he will get 20 years. So, each player has a lot of incentive to deviate in order to confess. For this reason, if both confess, they will get at the end 8 years each. It should be the worst, actually. Like, between them, it should be better this one. Automatically, you kind of understand that this is kind of cooperation, but this should be the outcome. Okay, let's think about it. So here, what about every time I suggest to discover the Nash equilibrium is to put bars under the outcome, and the square that it has two bars, it should be the Nash equilibrium. Okay, so here, why I put this one? I put this one because if Bonnie's confess, what should be better for Clyde? Confess or remain silent? If I remain silent or Clyde remains silent, get 20 years. Or if he confesses, he will get 8 years. So definitely this one should be better than this one. So for this reason, I underlined this one. Then, this one, if this guy remains silent, what should be better? Remain silent, I will get 1 year, or I will be free. Okay, so this one is the decision. Is the decision. So automatically you understand that this confess, this is a dominant strategy for Clyde. It doesn't matter what Bonnie will move, all the time I will use or I will choose confess. Okay, let's think about this one. So the dominant strategy is confess. Now, Bonnie, what about the Clyde confess? What I prefer, what Bonnie prefers? Stays in jail 8 years or 20 years? Naturally, 8 years. So this should be the decision when Clyde confesses. And when Clyde remains silent, what about remain go free or get 1 year? So Bonnie will go free. So where are the two bars? The two bars, they are here. So for this reason, we already understand that confess is exactly a dominant strategy for Bonnie. So for this reason, both will be confessing. So for this reason, dominant strategy as a definition, we can define as the best possible strategy regardless the strategy of the other player. So I don't care what the other will move, but anytime he moves this one or he moves the other one, I will use this one. So this is a dominant strategy. So for this reason, the situation should be confess and confess. So then, then once we have here the final outcome should be the Nash equilibrium, where remember both players didn't have any incentive to move. This one even was better, it had a lot of incentives to deviate, because from this one Bonnie will confess because we'll go free, and then Clyde's decision, he will confess as well. So for this reason, this is not possible to reach because they have a lot of incentives to deviate. At the end of the day, they will choose this one, where no one wants to move, because if Bonnie move, he will get 20 years, and if Clyde move, he will get 20 years. So then cooperation is individually irrational. And then we have this situation of the same of the prisoner's dilemma, but with situation of duopolist. Then we have two firms. Well, actually, we have two people here. We have Jack and Jill. So here they have two decisions, high production or low production, 40 and 30 each one. Remember, for monopolies, it's better to produce less, where they will have more benefits. It will be this one. This should be the well that we studied before, remember, and then it should be the best one, 1-800. But then they have a lot of incentive to move, because Jack will produce more because he will get 2,000. So for this reason, he has incentive to move, and then Jill as well, because instead of getting 1,800, he would like to get 2,000. So then they both have incentives to move as a high production, and at the end of the day they will have 1,600, which should be even lower than the total that they will get here because of lack of cooperation. So the companies would really like to reach the monopolies.com, which should be this one. Okay, both producers agree to keep 30 gallons, profit will be the maximum, but even the agreement they have the possibility to ignore it. So for this reason, the idea is like, let's represent that as a Nash equilibrium. So let's think about Jack. What about if Jill produce high, if they have like high production? What should be better for Jack, 1,600 or 1,500? Should be different, this one. What about if this one, they produce low, 30 gallons? So the total one should be naturally 2,000, it's better than 1,800. The other side, Jill, what about Jack produce high? So then should be better, 1,600 or 1,500? Naturally, 1,600. And then here should be better, 2,000 instead of 1,800. So then this one, when we have the two bars, this is considered the Nash equilibrium. Remember, the Nash equilibrium is the point where they don't have any incentive to deviate. So then the dominant strategy, automatically you understand dominant strategy should be high production for both, okay, for Jill and for Jack. So each producer has a lot of incentive to cheat. So then for that reason, this is not reached the best result, but the result reached is the Nash equilibrium, where even the total profit is less than the other situation where cooperation exists. Then here we have an arm play, so another representation of prisoner's dilemma, where we have the decision of the U.S., the decision of the USSR. So here they have two options, arm or disarm. The idea is like, let's find the Nash equilibrium. So then, imagine that U.S. decision was arm. So what should be better for the USSR? At risk or at risk and weak? Okay, should be better, just risk. When U.S. disarm, what should be better? USSR safe and powerful or just safe? That should be better, safe and powerful. So dominant strategy for the Soviet Union should be arm, and for the other one should be if the USSR chooses arm, the better decision what should be, US at risk or at risk and weak? Definitely at risk. And then safe and powerful or safe? Should be better, safe and powerful. So this should be the outcome reached, which again is not the most efficient from them because they will be better when both are safe. Okay, so then this is, as I said, decision to produce arms. So this is like dilemma here, because each country prefers to have more arms. It will give more influence on war affairs, but at the same time they preferred as well to live in a place with peace. Okay, so this is the problem. Then another example of the prisoner dilemma. We already know about common resources. Actually, we had a look in chapter 11. The people tend to overuse resources. So then we have two companies, Exxon and Texaco. They own adjacent oil fields. So the common pool between them of oil worth 12 million. And then drilling a well to recover the oil cost 1 million. And actually, each company will drill a well. So then, if company drills one well, each will have half of the oil, okay, and then should be 5 million profit. Why? Because the total revenue, we already know that is 12 million, but there is a cost, and the cost should be 2 million, 1 million each company in order to drill a well, and then the profit should be the total revenue minus the total cost. Total revenue is 12, and total cost should be 2, okay, and then the profit should be 10 divided 2, should be 5 million profit each one. And then imagine that they can drill a new well. So then one kind of deviate, because they will say, okay, I will produce another one. So then the profit should be split between the wells. And if one company owns two wells, so definitely that we have 2/3 of the production, okay, of the total revenue. So then for this reason, each well will return as a total revenue 4 million each well. So then the company with two wells should have as a total revenue 8 million, and the profit should be 8 minus 2, because 2 are the cost of the production, the cost of drilling that well. So then it should be 6, which is definitely higher than 5. So for this reason, there is an incentive to deviate. And the other one that just has one well should be the 4, the total revenue minus 1, which is the cost of drilling one well. So the profit should be 3. So then imagine that both drills two wells. If both drill two wells, now it should be not split by 3, but should be split by 4. So then should be 3 million each one. So the profit should be 6 minus the cost of the two wells should be 2. Then should be 4 million. So definitely is not profitable. Okay. So then they will stop there. So this is like the conclusion here. So we have this one representing a prisoner's dilemma situation in a table 2x2. Then the situation is you have two decisions, drill two wells or drill one. And then the best benefit should be when they just drill one, because both will get 5. Again, the same situation. Understand that this is not sustainable, because, for example, Exxon will say, okay, I already have 5, but if I deviate, I will get 6. And the other situation, the same, Texaco, I already have 5, but if I deviate, I will get 6. So it's better to deviate. So because of self-interest and lack of cooperation, they will finish here. Okay? And we can represent that as the bars, as we said before. So then, what is the best situation for Texaco 1? Exo says drill two wells. It should be better 4 or 3. Okay? Definitely 4. And then, what about if this one, the Exxon, drill one well? So what should be better? 6 or 5? Definitely 6. So this is the dominant strategy for Texaco, drill two wells. And Exxon decision, what about the Texaco, they decide drill two wells, what should be better, two wells or one well? Definitely two wells, because they will get 4. And then what about if Texaco decides to drill just one well? The better situation should be this one. Then for this situation, this should be the Nash equilibrium. Well, when again, this is not the best one, because they will get better income here, but due to the lack of cooperation and self-interest motivation, they will get to this one. So then, with the prisoner's dilemma and the welfare society between participants, so inside them, The lack of cooperation is worse, but not for society. When we talk about monopoly, obviously they will have less benefits, but for society it will be better because competition will bring lower prices and more variety. For example, in the armed race, the final outcome is force for all society because they continue to produce arms. So in this particular game, this is even worse, the competition, so it is better to cooperate. The situation of Exxon and Texaco is worse for society because it should be more externalities, negative externalities for contamination, so they definitely should be better that they cooperate for that. Then in the case of monopoly, result is not reached, that is better for society. As I said before, when we talk about monopoly and this is not reached, this is better for society because the prices should be lower and more quantities. Then why people sometimes cooperate? So here we have the, for example, situation between the world. So sometimes the problem of deviation can be solved. And how? Actually, when the game is played several times, you know that, okay, I deviate. For example, here, in the games of the gallons, when played once, the outcome should be deviation. I'm not going to play with that guy anymore, so I guess that I can deviate, or it should be okay, because I will risk to have this 2,000 profit. But they can enforce agreement once there is a play several times played, because once one of them reneges, both should produce 30 forever. So they say, okay, I'm going to punish you. The time you deviate, the next time you will just produce 30 gallons. So for this reason, I can produce then the next time and all time 40 gallons. So definitely my benefit should be higher. So for this reason, maybe it should be a way to enforce, punish people in order to keep the promises. So when cheating, for 1 week the firm will have $2,000 instead of $160, but then they will have just $1,500. Then it should be not any incentive to deviate when the play is when the game is played forever. So next week both will have $160 when they just both, they have this situation that they don't cooperate. Then the public policy toward oligopolies. So one of the first 10 principles that we saw in the first chapter is that government can improve market outcomes. So sometimes there should be some intervention and the outcome should be better. So then the idea is like the policymakers should induce firms to compete instead of cooperate, because we already know that competition should be better for the society in terms of lower prices and more quantities. So here there is a restraint of trade on the antitrust laws. So one of the first 10 principles says that something can improve market outcomes, said before, and the policymakers should induce firms to compete instead of cooperate. I said before, sorry, I guess that I paste a copy the same. But the Justice Department and private parties have the authority to force antitrust laws, avoid excessive market power. This is the basic idea of the antitrust policy. Then we have three controversies. Because why they are controversies? Because sometimes we see that they represent a problem of the higher market power, but sometimes we see that they are legitimate in order to improve the situation of consumers and total society. So for example, we have a wholesaler that they produce $100 and the retailer cannot sell more than $150. So this is the resale price maintenance. So then kind of something that maybe is not okay, because actually the wholesale producer, they can accept the power market just in the price and not the one offered by retailers. So they should control the price that they sell to retailers. Okay, they said, okay, I will fix 90 and you can make whatever you want with that. You can sell 10% more, 20% more, so on and so forth. But actually, the idea is like the wholesale producer, they have no incentive that retailers sell less. Okay, so for this reason, actually, because the problem of them is they need to sell to retailers and they don't care about retailers what they do. But actually it has a legitimate goal, because when they fix a higher price, they actually, the retailers ensure that it should be a better showroom and actually better teamed with more knowledge of the product and can express better, the product should be guaranteed. So maybe for this reason it should be a legitimate goal, and maybe it should be something that resale price maintains. It's kind of okay, or maybe it's not okay. So for this reason it's kind of a controversy. So business practices that appear to reduce competition may in fact have legitimate purposes. And then another one is the predatory pricing. So for example, at that time the policymakers sometimes should or shouldn't be afraid of low prices in the market. Because for example, imagine that there is a monopoly of that airline, the Coyote Air, and some route, but actually the Roadrunner Express enters and takes 20% of the market, leaving the other one with just 80%. Then Coyote can slash it first, and then it will again a monopoly. So this can have a high cost because there should be losses, and sometimes the price offered should be even lower than the cost just in order to keep the power of the market. So then the problem here from policymakers is like it's so difficult to identify for courts when the price is really predatory, when they actually they are trying to take out the other player of the market, or just this is just too due to competition. And the other one is time, because when you have time, actually for example you have like this firm make money movies, they produce two new films, and then they offer these movies to the theaters and the two films together as a single price rather than separately. This is tying two products. And actually imagine that one is for private producer and the other one is not profit organization. This should be kind of way to increase power, market power in other kind of market. And actually at the end of the day, the theaters, they can value those firms in a different way. And when you tie them, you are making kind of a discrimination, and you're making more, paying more for films that maybe the theaters, they are not interested on projecting them. So for this reason should be a problem, or maybe should be a problem for kind of market power, for antitrust policy, but time should be seen carefully as the other ones. So as a conclusion, we know that the oligopolies, the best idea that they really would like to act as a monopolist, but self-interest drives the towards competition. So it depends definitely on the number and they want to cooperate or not. Definitely when they cooperate, they will reach better results, but it doesn't mean that the better results for society, but definitely for the players. But most of the times, due to pursuing self-interest, they will have as an outcome competition where they don't have the best benefits just because they have a lot of incentive to deviate. So policymakers regulate their behaviors through antitrust laws, but actually sometimes the agreement could be based on legitimate background, so they should be carefully analyzed if they need to intervene or maybe not. So that's all for today. I guess it has worth for you. As any time you are free to comment, I'm just here making my point of view. If you can say something or to build better knowledge, I'm more than open. Okay, have a great day. See you. Bye bye.